China's economy has, of course, not been immune from the global economic slowdown. While the Republic's boom has buoyed the global economy, its growth is slowing down. To tell us more about what that means, we're joined from Vancouver, British Columbia, via Skype by Yuen Pau. He is the president and CEO of the Asia Pacific Foundation of Canada. And Yuen Pau, it's always good to have you on TVO. How are you today?
Very well. Thanks for having me on the show.
Our pleasure. I want to start by talking about China's growth rate, which, of course, has for many years been going at double digits. It's now down below double digits, and there is some concern that it's going to be below 8. Just before we talk more specifically about that, I want to know why 8% is considered so important slash magical for China to achieve in terms of growth rates.
It's not magical, but 8% is the notional figure that's seen to be necessary to generate economic activity and hence jobs in order to absorb the very large number of workers coming into the workforce every year. These are workers who are not only coming of age to enter the workforce, but also workers from the rural areas who are migrating to cities in search for non-rural labor. For China to not be able to provide jobs to this massive influx into the labor market risks social unrest, and that is really the ultimate fear of the Chinese government, not slow growth per se, but the social consequences of slow growth.
Could you go into that a little bit more? In other words, if growth rates are less than 8%, what does the regime fear are the consequences of that?
You know, the legitimacy of all governments is performance in one way or form. In democracies, of course, the populace has the ability to vote out the government after a certain period of time if they feel that performance is not forthcoming. In China, there is an understanding, and it's worked very well in the last 60 years almost, where the legitimacy of the Communist Party is based on its performance, what they call performance legitimacy. And that performance is measured quite simply in terms of economic welfare, providing the goods, if you will, and in turn, having the kind of social stability that allows economic growth to proceed. Growth that falls much below 8% will make it more difficult for the Chinese government to generate jobs and material benefits, which in turn undermines their legitimacy as the government of the day.
And the Premier of the People's Republic had some pretty dramatic things to say about the nature of the economy, Wen Jiabao warning that China's economy is, quote, unstable, unbalanced, uncoordinated, and unsustainable. What's he referring to there?
This is going to be known as the four uns. Well, all of those points are correct, and they are not news to most observers of the Chinese economy. Essentially, what he's saying is that the Chinese economy is going through a structural change where it cannot rely on external markets as the principal source of growth. It cannot rely on cheap labor as the principal source of job creation. It cannot rely on infrastructure development, large-scale construction of roads and bridges, and particularly buildings as a source of growth. And it cannot rely on reckless exploitation of the environment in order to generate jobs and growth. It has to transition to an economy that is sustainable, and that means fundamentally shifting the source of demand away from exports to more of a domestically demand-driven economy, and one which, if you will, shares the spoils more evenly between the owners of capital and the workers. It's funny for a communist nation to be facing this challenge, but that's exactly where they are. Labor, in a sense, has been exploited for many years. The share of growth, the share of the benefits of growth has gone mostly to the government and to the state-owned enterprises, and there's a need now to redistribute, if you will.
That's an interesting irony you just pointed out, and I wonder if you have any knowledge as to whether or not the Chinese government finds that equally ironic.
Oh, I'm sure they do, and above all, they recognize it because they are being told this very contradiction, if you will. The performance legitimacy is not just that the government will generate the economic growth that will produce the goodies, but also that the government will look after the people. The Communist Party made that pledge to take care of the people, if you will, and we know from the early years after the revolution, there was a system of, medical, rudimentary, but nevertheless, a system of medical care and housing that was provided to the workers. You know, the so-called tanwei, the work units, not only paid the workers a small amount, but they also provided housing and other social benefits. That whole system is crumbling because of the transition to a more market economy. And the critics, the so-called new left critics in China, are pointing that out very, very starkly to the Communist Party, to the government, and the government recognizes it.
So if the economy is slowing down, and you've described what the potential consequences of that could be, as you analyze it, what do you think the number one economic priority of the Chinese government ought to be now?
It's the management of the transition away from a focus on investment in infrastructure in particular, a shift away from the focus on export orientation to more of a domestically oriented economy. But to do that in such a way that does not create a very sharp dislocation and disruption in the existing economic model. You can't have a transition to a domestically driven economy simply by closing all of the export-oriented factories in the southern coastal parts of China. And because the world economy is in a funk and likely to remain in a funk for a number of more years, it's very difficult for the Chinese to effect this transition, because even without the Chinese plan to shift demand to domestic sources, the export sector is already suffering from the lack of demand in the EU, in the United States, and other international markets.
You and I have talked about corruption in the Chinese government on this program in the past, and I'm wondering whether you see any evidence that the government seems seized enough of the seriousness of this issue to start doing something about it. What do you think?
Oh, they recognize the problem, and again, they recognize it above all because the blogs and the critics within the party and outside the party and the citizens are pointing it out to them. And we have a number of high-profile cases that underscore how deep and serious this problem is. So I have no doubt that the Chinese government recognizes the problem and wants to deal with it. They have, of course, a very big challenge. This is, again, part of the transition, if you will, in that many of the corrupt practices or nepotism or kind of borderline fringe benefits, shall we put it, that party leaders benefit from are widespread. And it's hard to single out cases of corruption without having the other fingers point back at you or other leaders. So they have to handle this delicately. They have to create a system where the leadership is, you know, maybe rewarded more generously for their service to the country without it being seen as corruption. But at the same time, to crack down on the most egregious cases of graft, corruption and much worse, criminality in business and in government dealings.
But every now and then you read stories about somebody being executed for corruption. Does that not have an impact?
Yeah, you know, the Chinese have a saying about, you know, killing the fox to scare off other predators. And that no doubt is a very strong signal. But the problem of corruption is deeply rooted. It's part of the system, if you will. And to address it will require more than showcase trials or high-profile executions. It will mean basically changing the incentive structures, the reward mechanism for officials and for party leaders. The same as in any other country. I mean, let's not you know, single out China for unique coverage here. But dealing with corruption fundamentally is not about harsh punishment, but it's about putting in place system of incentives and rewards and accountability that makes sense. So right now, you have party leaders or leaders of state organs that are, in theory, paid very little, even though they have huge responsibility. The Chinese have to find a way to not only pay them more, but justify paying them more.
In which case, let me follow up with this. How would you say that China's obviously one-party system either limit or helps the government's ability to address the economic problems we've been talking about?
It's both a help and a hindrance. It's a help in the sense that they can mobilize very quickly, make decisions, turn on a dime, if you will. And when a decision has been made, they can drive that decision through the system without much hesitation and sort of dithering. And we saw that in the 2008-2009 period where the world was on the brink. China came through with a massive and overwhelming fiscal stimulus package that was pushed through very quickly and was implemented by and large successfully. One might say in projects that were unproductive, but the point is that they were able to get this to happen. So the one-party rule, if you will, has that advantage. But we all know the limitations of centralized authority as well, the protection of vested interests, the, you know, tendency of groupthink and bad decision-making. Again, though, let's not single out China as too much of a special case. There's a lot of groupthink in the West as well. When I think of the Eurozone problems, you know, one of the serious challenges they face is groupthink around the role of central banks and stimulus and the treatment of peripheral versus core economies. But the Chinese understand this problem and they are trying to effect a transition, again, that's the key word, to a more democratic, if you will, more open system. And they already have, over the years, built up what they call inner party democracy. So the debates take place within the party. And I'd like to think that that helps improve decision making.
No, that's a fair point. But let me crudely, if I can, summarize what the deal, if I can put it that way, between the party and the proletariat has been for the last few decades, which is the party's going to help you all grow rich, but in turn, don't mess with the party's monopoly on power. Do you think that deal, if I can put it that way, still exists in the minds of most Chinese?
It's being eroded, and the term that's been used by some scholars is the zones of indifference, which the Chinese government has demarcated. Those zones are growing bigger and bigger. You know, there were much larger areas of public discourse and political sensitivity that were simply no-go zones, and these have been eroded over the years. But the primacy of the party is sacrosanct. The leadership role of the party and criticism of the party is still very much not tolerated from outside of party apparatus. So I think that is still the deal. I think by and large, the Chinese people accept that. I don't see a mass call for multi-party democracy, but there's no question that Chinese people want more say in the decisions that affect their lives.
I want to play you a clip at this stage, if I can, which is of Claremont McKenna College's Min-Shin Pei, whom I'm sure you know, whom we had on this program earlier this year talking about crony capitalism. So listen to this clip, and then we'll come back with a question. Roll tape, please.
Once China joined the WTO, China's foreign trade grew tremendously, and China's growth rate accelerated, and that took off the pressure for economic reform. In China, when you look at its history, economic reform accelerates only when there is a lot of external and internal pressure. In other words, crisis leads to reform, growth hampers reform.
So the question becomes, does China need a crisis in order to spur on economic reform today?
We should all hope and pray that there isn't a crisis in China. And while crises perhaps have good outcomes in retrospect, one should always look for reform through periods of relative stability. It's not correct to say that the period of rapid growth post-WTO entry did not bring about any reform. Indeed, I would argue somewhat the contrary. WTO entry put in place a system of economic liberalization and reform of economic freedoms, particularly personal economic freedoms, that precisely has paved the way for the kind of personal calls for greater liberties in spaces outside of the economic sphere. If you have the ability to choose how you spend your money and where you travel for your holidays and what job you take up, you will also want to have views on the newspapers you read and what you see in the official press and ultimately on who represents you at the township or the village or the national level. So WTO entry and the reforms, the economic reforms that were ushered in as a result of WTO entry were an important contributor to the reform process. Some of that has stalled, I don't deny it. But there's no question that we saw reform take place through the 2000s period.
Let's spend our last couple of minutes here just looking forward a bit if we can, and I'd like to get your take on whether you agree with those economists who say that at some point over the next decade, China is going to surpass the United States as the world's largest economy. What do you think?
Yes, and the most revealing part of that statement is how the crossover date, if you will, has been brought forward by as much as a decade, as far as the latest estimates have it. It used to be 2050, then it was 2030, and then 2020. I've seen a recent estimate putting it as close as 2017. But let's not get too excited about it. China has a lot of people. For it to become a larger economy in gross terms is almost inevitable as long as growth keeps up. But China is still a poor economy on a per capita basis. Chinese citizens are much less affluent than Americans or Europeans or Canadians. And that's in some ways a more important factor than just the aggregate size of the economy.
And just finally, what would you say the likelihood is of the Chinese economy not slowing down gingerly, but rather having a hard landing at some point in the next year or two?
Less than 50%. Not a zero probability. There is room for a lot of things to go wrong, particularly if the world economy goes into an even deeper funk, which makes it more difficult for China to effect the transition to domestic demand growth. Basically, what the Chinese have to forestall a hard landing is domestic firepower, you know, fiscal stimulus and some monetary stimulus. But that's a very dangerous tool to use because a lot of that spending could be wasteful and could simply store up problems for the future. So the soft landing is as much dependent on the state of the world economy as it is on sensible and thoughtful intervention on the part of Chinese authorities.
Yuen Pau, we always appreciate your sensitive and thoughtful contributions to this program. So thanks again for joining us from Vancouver.
Thanks, Steve.
Support Ontario's public television. Donate at tvo.org.